So today we're going to be talking about a really nice property that many functions have, especially the kinds of functions we're going to be considering. And this property we've kind of implicitly talked about many times, and we may have heard it referred to before as the ability to draw without lifting your pencil. We're going to call it continuity. Now we've actually encountered continuous functions. Like I said, most functions that we're going to encounter are continuous, but let's specifically start with our motivation. So let's start with the best set of functions, which are the polynomials. All right, so recall, polynomials have this really nice form. They're combinations of powers of x. So what makes polynomials so nice, at least from our perspective for right now, is that polynomials are not surprising in the following sense, that if I have any polynomial at all, and I have any choice for the value a, then the limit as x gets closer to a of that polynomial p of x is what happens when you plug p of a in. Okay, so why is that nice? Well, if you think about what's being represented here, this left-hand side, when we talk about limits, this is what should happen. Because that's what limits measure. They say, well, what should happen to the function at a? And the p of a, this is what does happen. So in other words, what's the value at a? So what should happen is what does happen. Another way to think of it is that your expectation matches your reality, which is sometimes a little bit hard to imagine in this world, right? But it can happen. So these are really nice functions. And we want to really study these functions because these are the functions which should have fairly reasonable properties. So any function which satisfies the fact that the limit as we approach a value is the same as the function at that, the function evaluated at that value, we're going to call it a special name. We're going to call them continuous. So we're going to talk about continuous functions. Now, there's three things that have to happen to be a continuous function. What do we need? Well, we need to have our limit has to exist because we need to compare the limit to something. The function has to be defined at our point. Then the last thing is these two values have to be the same. So we need that equality. So if any one of those three fails, then our function is not continuous. And sometimes we use the phrase discontinuous. Now for right now, we're just talking about continuity at a particular point. So of course, functions can have many points and all sorts of things can happen. So what are some ways that we might have problems? In other words, what are some ways that we might have a discontinuity? Well, we're going to sort of group them into three main categories. And one of them is I'll just give away at the very bottom here, is called other. And so really we have two special types of discontinuities. So the first type of discontinuity we want to talk about is what's called removable. Now, removable implies, hey, I'm not continuous, but with a little bit of work, you might persuade me to become continuous. So when does that happen? Well, okay, so it's not continuous at x equals a, but what can happen is that the limit as x goes to a of f of x exists. See, the limit is sort of the hard part. Among the three requirements, the limit existing is the hard one. The function being defined and them being equal can always be fixed by saying, okay, maybe the function is not defined. Well, just figure out what the limit is. Fill in the hole. Or maybe it is defined, but it was defined so that they're not equal. Okay, good. Now redefine it. So what's an example of something with the removable discontinuity? Well, suppose you look at the function f of x, which is sine of x over x. We talked about this function before. Now, this is a very nice function as long as you stay away from zero. At zero, it doesn't make any sense because you get 0 over 0. But we know something. We know that the limit as x goes to 0 of sine of x over x is 1. It's a beautiful property. Wonderful. So what does that mean? Well, it means the limit of the function exists, but the function, as it's currently defined, isn't defined for 0. So that's a discontinuity, but we can fix it. And the way you fix it is you say, hey, let's expand our definition for f of x So we'll say it's sine x over x if we're not 0, and then it's 1 if we are 0. So sort of the visual way to think about a removable discontinuity is that there's a hole. So for us, sine x over x, it turns out to have sort of this shape here. It's the sine function, but it's being damped as you head off to larger and larger values of x. So the goal when we talk about removable discontinuity is fill the hole, fill the hole. Okay, now the next type, a jump discontinuity. So a jump discontinuity happens when we look at our limit, it doesn't exist. And the reason it doesn't exist is when you come in from the right, it's different than when you come in from the left. In other words, they have different values. Now, I can't remove it because that limit can never exist. So what does it look like? Well, a jump discontinuity pictorially would be something where you come in and then you jump to a different value coming out. Now, the actual value of the function could be defined at anywhere or possibly not even defined at all. It might be down here, for instance. But now you can see visually it makes sense of why we call it a jump discontinuity, because we have to really jump to keep going here. So this is a jump. We should mark this. And all right, so those are pretty straightforward. Now, what's our last one? Well, our last one is everything else. It's the other. So you might say, well, what does that include? Well, it could include things where the limit is undefined or there's blowing up. So one thing you might see is things where you have something crazy going on. Like what? Well, we can have a function, say, g of x, which is 1 over x squared if we're below 0, 2 if we're at 0, and sine of 1 over x if we're above 0. That's a perfectly valid function, because for every value for x, I've told you explicitly how to compute what it is. What it looks like is on the left-hand side towards 0, it's 1 over x squared. It's blowing up. So that's a problem. It's this limit that's getting arbitrarily large. You might say it's heading off to infinity. And then there's 2 at 0. And then sine of 1 over x, it's again, we talked about this function before, but it has this behavior where it oscillates up and down. So we can have all sorts of things. So essentially, what falls into the other category is whenever the limit doesn't exist. So if it's discontinuous and the limit exists, it's removable. If it's discontinuous and the left-right-hand limits exist but aren't equal, it's a jump. And otherwise, it's some other discontinuity. And those are pretty much harder to deal with. And we'll see those less often. So these are the types of discontinuities you should be on the lookout for. So that's continuity at a point. Now we can also talk about continuity of functions. We say a function is continuous if it's continuous at every point. Now we like continuous functions. And almost every function that you're going to see in our calculus journey is going to be a function which is either continuous or made of a nice set of pieces which are continuous. So what kind of functions might we encounter? Well, polynomials, rational functions. Now, rational functions are where you have a polynomial over a polynomial. Now, rational functions are fine as long as we stay away from where the denominator is 0. E to the x, great function. Sine x, cosine x, arctangent of x, arctangent of x, another beautiful function. We're going to have a lot of fun with arctangent of x this class. Now, there are other functions which have problem areas, things like log, secant, tangent. And when I say they have problem areas, they have these asymptotes where you shoot off towards positive infinity or maybe shoot off to negative infinity. As long as you avoid those areas, the rest of them are perfectly fine. Now, why do we like the continuous functions? Well, we like continuous functions because they have really nice properties. One of the nicest properties they have is the following fact. If a function is continuous, then the limit is really simple in the following sense. The limit as x approaches a of g of x equals g of a if our function g is continuous at a. So, well, now I'm not sure. Continuous? Oh, that might be right. So in other words, if I know my function is continuous and I'm trying to understand a limit, then I can say, well, hold on, let me just check. Continuous? Good. Plug it in. And then we're done. And that doesn't require any work. So we want to be able to say, hey, that's a continuous function. All's good here. So how do we recognize continuous functions? We have some basic building blocks. These are our basic building blocks of continuous functions. And now what we can do is talk about ways to combine things together. So what can we do? Well, we can add two continuous functions. That's a continuous function. I can multiply by a scalar number. So this is it looks like a small k. It's actually a kappa, but we're friends. So if you want to call it small k, that's great. So kappa f of x, that's going to be continuous if f of x is continuous. If I multiply two continuous functions, that's still continuous. If I divide two continuous functions, it's going to be continuous except where the denominator is zero. Now, where the denominator is zero, you might be able to patch it if it's removable. You might not. It just depends on what's happening. And a really important thing is composition. So that's f of g of x. So one of the basic things you want to do with functions is put one function inside of another function. Sometimes we can think of these as a chain of functions. And when we do that, that helps us to sort of say, hey, I might have something that looks really big and complicated, but I go through and look and say, oh, it's a composition of nice functions or product of nice functions or sums of nice functions. And then I can say, whoa, this is a nice function. And I can use my properties of nice functions. All right, well, that's continuous functions. One more thing to talk about, and that is the intermediate value theorem. And it's kind of an intuitive thing, and it's something that we kind of all agree on, that it makes sense. And it says, suppose we're continuous. This, by the way, what might be helpful to keep in mind is you sometimes hear of a continuous function is one where you can't draw it without lifting your pen or can't draw without lifting your pencil. All right, so that might be a nice thing to keep in mind. All right, so what do we have? We have a function is continuous from A to B, and then for any choice of t between f of A and f of B. So here, when I'm talking about our value for t, you can see it's between f of A and f of B. So that means that t falls in this range from between f of A and f of B. It's something dealing with, in essence, the output. And what it says is, hey, if I want to choose anything between these two extreme points, then let's say I pick some value t here, there has to be at least one, possibly more than one, but at least one c between a and b, where when I plug c into the function, I get t. So the way you should think of it is, if I pick a t here, I can go out and I can, so I'm plotting here, what'll happen is, the claim is, it's going to hit the function at least one point. Now, it might hit at several points. It's okay. It's not saying that there's a unique one. It's saying there's at least one. So, for instance, this one is perfectly fine. So here is the C, so that when I plug it into the function, the output is T. And that'll be true for regardless of where you pick. See, up here, if I had picked, I'd only hit at one point. That's okay. That's fine. The thing is, you have to have at least one point. And that's the important thing. Now, one of the things about the intermediate value theorem is we want to make sure that we know what it says, but also we want to make sure we know what it doesn't say. So a lot of people hear the intermediate value theorem, and they start sort of implicitly putting on things which aren't true. Now, one of the big things that often gets attached to it is it says, hey, my function has to stay in between. So the intermediate value theorem, the idea is, if I know my function here at A and I know my function here at B, I'm always going to be between the two as I go between A and B. And that's not the case. So you can see, as this example shows, you can dip down below. Or you could dip down above. That's perfectly fine. So be careful. Make sure you understand it. Now you might be thinking, okay, how can I get this back to continuity? Well, the idea is, imagine that you're starting up here at A, F of A. You're ending down here, B, F of B. And we're going to do the not lift our pen. We want to pass from that point to that point. And the rule is, we can't lift our pen. Can we do it without crossing T? And you can imagine, let's come over here. So here's our T, and we want to get from here to there. And the problem is, you might say, okay, well, nope, coming too close, okay. Well, let me try again. No, I'm going to cross. Okay, come down again. All right, and give up. Now, you might think, okay, well, you're just doing it wrong. I know how to do this because I'm an expert. I've been studying this for years. So you might think what you need to do is you need to go look for the right place. So you go look for a pipe. And then you're like, okay, so if I'm here and I went end up down here, you just sort of start going. And you're like, look, we made it, right? We just had to find that. But here's the thing. This doesn't exist. See, that's not how the number system works. You can't somehow, there's no magic pipe. There's no skipping over. You have to hit everything that starts from here to there. In other words, no matter what you pick, you will hit it. And that's the intermediate value theorem. Now, how can you use it? Well, oftentimes what you can use it to say is there a certain value which satisfies a relationship? And if you know what you're dealing with is continuous, and you say, well, here I know I'm below what I want, here I'm above what I want, then somewhere you have to be exactly what you want. So in some sense, the intermediate value theorem is useful because it can help you find roots. And roots are really important. All right, well, that's the idea for now. And of course, as always, now we should probably do a little bit of practice.